Welcome, everyone. I'm Karabelki Ungerman, Director of Nutrition and Dietetics at the National Pork Board, and I'm so excited that you've joined us for today's webinar. With discussions about food inflation, hunger, and nutrition security at an all-time high, one word comes to mind for how we move forward, and that's collaboration. That's why on today's webinar, you're going to hear from experts in academia, NGOs, and former government employees about what it takes to create a nutritionally optimized, affordable eating plan, and then how to put this knowledge into practice. At the National Pork Board, we know that pork has a huge role to play in these discussions. After all, pork is a high-quality, affordable, and nutrient-dense protein that satisfies many tastes and cultural preferences. And that's why our producers are passionate about advancing research and knowledge on this topic so that we can bring people together to be part of the solution. So with that, let's go ahead and get started with our first poll of the day. You should see a screen pop up in front of you. So I'd love to know how many of you out there have heard of the Thrifty Food Plan before today's webinar. So if you haven't done so already, go ahead and select your responses now. We'll give you just a few seconds here. And Nate, if we could go ahead and see, what do the results say? Let's see. It looks like 53% of you said yes, you've heard of the Thrifty Food Plan before today. So that's great. I'm super excited to have so many experts on the call, and I hope that today isn't our last engagement together. And for the remaining percent of you, over 40% of you that have not heard of it, well, you've come to the right place because we've gathered the right group of experts to teach you more about the Thrifty Food Plan, and you'll just learn a lot from our experts today. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to our moderator for the day, Marvin Cantave.
Thank you, Kara, and thank you all for joining us today for our webinar titled Putting the Thrifty Food Plan into Action, Insights from Food Modeling Research. As Kara said, we have a special group of subject matter experts here for you today who are ready to inform you in three key areas. But before we do that, I just want to mention to you guys to keep an eye out on the chat because this is where we'll post resource alerts, have some polling for you to fill out, and much more. So firstly, today, we'll learn about the food modeling research that went into informing the Thrifty Food Plan. Secondly, you'll leave here empowered with practical tips on incorporating the Thrifty Food Plan into your everyday practice. And thirdly, you'll deepen your understanding on the importance and need for frequent reevaluation of the Thrifty Food Plan. So before introducing you to our expert panel, I just want to give you guys a brief overview of the Thrifty Food Plan itself. Next slide, please. So originally developed as the Economy Food Plan in 1962 and renamed in 1975, the Thrifty Food Plan is one of four USDA meal plans used to represent a healthy diet at four different cost levels. Being the lowest cost food plan, the Thrifty Food Plan is used as the basis for maximum SNAP benefit allotments. And within the Thrifty Food Plan are market baskets containing commonly consumed foods that are lower in price and higher in nutritional quality. With the 2018 Farm Bill came a periodic reevaluation requirement and a shift away from market baskets that focused on a cost neutral effect towards market baskets that focused on a consumption optimization effect. So if you remember anything from what I just said right there, remember these two key takeaways. The 2021 update was the first time in its history that the Thrifty Food Plan was updated to not be kept cost neutral. And also the Thrifty Food Plan was updated sporadically in the past, but will now be reevaluated every 5 years. Next slide, please. Please check out the chat for some brief bios on today's presenters. So today we have with us Dr. Adam Drewnowski, Professor of Epidemiology at the University of Washington and the Director of the Center for Public Health Nutrition at the University School of Public Health. Shelley Maniscalco, founding partner of Nutrition on Demand and the former director of the Office of Nutrition Marketing and Promotion at USDA Center for Nutrition Policy. And lastly, but not least, Shelley Vollinger, director at Food Research and Action Center, or what you guys would know as FRAC. Thank you to all our presenters for being here today, and we look forward to a great presentation. And with that, I'll pass it over to Dr. Drewnowski.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I will talk today about pork in sustainable healthy diets, and I will deal with modeling that we have done to optimize diet quality at an affordable cost. Let's go on to the next slide. which shows my disclosures. And let's move on to the next slide, where I introduce the concept of sustainable healthy diets. What are they and where does pork fit in? So the first important concept is this. Very often, we think that there are only two dimensions of sustainability, nutrition and the environment. That is not exactly correct. In reality, there are four dimensions of sustainability: nutrition, economics, society, and the environment. Ideally, foods and diets ought to be safe and healthy, affordable, socially and culturally acceptable, and with low impact on the environment. Each of those dimensions has its own metrics and measures. Today, I will talk about two of those: nutrition and health, and economics. Let's go on to the next slide. This one shows you the Thrifty Food Plan is on the interface of diet quality, nutrient density of the diet, and its price, because really we're talking about affordable, healthy diets. And of course, the Thrifty Food Plan also engages society. There are issues here about security, equity, diversity, and inclusion, and cultural appropriateness of foods for various population subgroups. So these are the three dimensions that we're going to be dealing with today. Today, I will not deal with the environmental impact. That is a topic for another day. But keep in mind the dimensions: nutrition, economics, and society, and all of those will come into play in the modeling that we have done. Let's go on to the next slide. There are a number of ideas I want to leave with you. The first one is that pork is an excellent source of protein. Pork is an excellent source of high quality protein at an affordable cost. I will show you the metrics and measures, and then I will discuss how pork fits into the Thrifty Food Plan and the optimized diets. So the first point is this. We have metrics of protein content of foods in grams per 100 grams, grams per serving, or grams of protein per 100 calories from a number of USDA databases. And then we have metrics of protein quality, the protein digestibility corrected amino acid score. And we can assess nutrient density of pork in different ways. But let me give you an example, which is on the next slide. This slide is taken from a big USDA database, the Food and Nutrient Database for Dietary Studies, 2015-2016. These are data for close to 7,000 foods, and those are the data which are used to calculate energy and nutrient intakes in the What We Eat in America studies. In other words, the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey. Those surveys are, in many cases, the basis for food and nutrition policy in the United States. So what do we see on this slide? We see bubbles. The size of each bubble corresponds to the number of foods per category. On the horizontal axis, you see grams of protein per 100 grams of food, edible portion. Take a look at the right-hand side of this graph. Take a look at the place of pork and chicken and turkey and beef and lamb and liver and fish and cheese, and notice that all those foods contain more than 20 grams of protein per 100 grams. In comparison, pasta, cakes, cereals contain much less protein. They contain plant protein. The foods on the right are animal protein foods, and they give you concentrated protein. So these are data expressed in terms of grams of protein per 100 grams. You see the exact same distribution on the next slide, which gives you now grams of protein per percent daily value, or percent daily value of protein per 100 grams. Daily value of protein is 50 grams, so the exact same slide, and it shows you again the place of pork and beef and lamb and chicken and turkey. You can redo it yet again. That's where the different metrics come in, and show percentage of protein in terms of calories. So these are now grams of protein per 100 percent daily value for protein per 100 calories of food. Again, see the difference between the animal products and the plant-based products on the left. So the point I'm trying to leave you with, that no matter what metric you're using, pork and animal proteins are concentrated sources of protein on the right of this scale. Let's go on to the next slide. So what you see here is evidence that not all proteins are of the same quality. The digestibility of proteins can be very different. And this is where the protein digestibility corrected amino acid score comes in, PDCAS. And look on the left at the factor 1 for milk and whey and pork and beef, very close to 1. And on the right-hand side, you see the data for plant proteins, cereals, wheat, rice, nuts, and so on. And notice the correction factor is much lower, which means that as you apply the protein quality correction to various foods, pork stays exactly where it was, so the chicken and beef, but notice that the relative shift in the position of seeds and nuts and crackers and cereals and all the plant foods with lower protein digestibility, protein quality score. They move to the left, the corrected protein content is lower. As I say, pork stays where it is an excellent source of high quality protein. The next set of slides, let's go on to the next one, deals with the issue of affordability. And for this, we have to do something special. The FNGDS database lists 83 fresh pork products. And we were able to obtain data from the USDA Thrifty Food Plan database, national food prices, which were adjusted to June 2021 prices. And those data were for about 3,000 foods. So we were able to merge food prices data with nutrient composition data to look at the relative affordability of protein sources. Some protein sources are expensive, some protein sources are inexpensive and provide high quality protein. Let's go on to the next slide. And this shows you the discrepancy in prices. Now protein content is on a vertical axis, so the foods high above are the ones with more protein. These are the same ones you've seen, chicken, pork, turkey, beef, and shellfish. But now on the horizontal axis, you see food cost in dollars per 100 calories based on national food prices. Shellfish, extremely expensive. Chicken and pork to the left of the scale, high quality protein, but at a very, very different and much lower price. Next slide shows you the same metric redone now in terms of percent daily value. Again, what you're seeing here is food costs in dollars per 100 calories. Again, take a look at the differential in cost for the various sources of high quality protein. Pork has a privileged place here. Let's move on here. Next slide. Because now, we start looking at the modeling of healthy diets and the place of pork in the Thrifty Food Plan 2021. So this modeling project was actually conducted by MS Nutrition, which is a startup in Marseille in France. These are brilliant young people who replicated the procedures of the Thrifty Food Plan using the same inputs, the same modeling categories, the same aggregation codes, and the same data. The food prices came from the publicly available data published by USDA Center for Nutrition Policy and Promotion. I want to say here that we were assisted in this project by USDA CNPP that provided valuable advice and assistance from Tusa Rebecca Panucci and her team, and the linear programming was done by Romain Ponceau and Mathieu Maillot in France. So let's see what happened here. Let's go on to the next slide. So linear programming is actually a procedure used to develop the Thrifty Food Plan. It's a linear programming exercise which creates a healthy food plan that fulfills a number of nutrition constraints and minimizes the price. So the Thrifty Food Plan healthy diets meets both nutrient and food group recommendations at the lowest cost. And the USDA CNPP created market baskets for 15 groups by age and gender, different ages, men and women, boys and girls. And they had a number of protein categories that they were trying to optimize. The protein categories were meat and poultry, eggs, seafood, and nuts. But in the USDA Thrifty Food Plan, the meat category included beef and pork. They were not disaggregated. And the Thrifty Food Plan did not provide relative amounts or cost of beef versus pork. Those were put together as the meat category. So we replicated those procedures with one major difference. We actually separated the beef from pork to see what was the place of pork specifically in the Thrifty Food Plan. So we're replicating the USDA Thrifty Food Plan, but going a step beyond. And I think we can see the inputs in the next slide. I will not give you too much detail. The Thrifty Food Plan was revised, as we just heard, for the first time in a long time. And the Thrifty Food Plan is used to set SNAP benefits for a family of four. It is now about $835 based on a market basket of 20 food categories. For our analyses, we bypassed vegetables and fruits and grains and focused only on protein foods. So go on to the next slide. And these are the inputs. We're using food prices, go from the top. We're creating mean consumption patterns for age, sex groups in enhanced data. We're making sure that the optimized diet follows all the dietary guidelines and is adequate in all the nutrients. And then we're using nutrient composition for the modeling categories from the USDA food FNDDS food and nutrient database for dietary studies. The LP models were pretty much the same ones as USDA. We used diet optimization linear programming, and then we came up with optimized amounts in grams per week and cost per week for the 99 modeling categories. And then we arrived at the market basket, which pretty much tracked the USDA market basket. As I say, we had very good assistance, much appreciated, from the USDA CNPP when we were doing the diet optimization program. Let's go on to the next slide. These were the models. I will not go into too much detail except to tell you that pork and beef were separated. We tried to minimize the cost, and then we did two separate models. In model 2A, all meat and poultry, beef, pork, lamb, chicken, were replaced by beef. In the model 2B, all meats and poultry were replaced by pork. So here we're doing a mimic of the Thrifty Food Plan and two additional models, pork versus beef. Let's go on to the next slide. So here you have the USDA Thrifty Food Plan on the left and our MS Nutrition Thrifty Food Plan version. At exactly the same cost, we're mimicking the cost. We're pretty much mimicking the cost per week of all the various categories, vegetables and fruits and grains are very similar to what the USDA had, but there is one difference. Our model actually selects pork to arrive at the same cost through the food plan. So we set the cost through the food plan, we separate beef and pork, and our model selects pork preferentially. And then we go on to minimize the cost further. Take a look at the next slide. And so here we have the Thrifty Food Plan in the first column. We have our version with minimal cost in the second column. And by replacing all the meats with pork, we actually arrive at an even lower cost of Thrifty Food Plan. In the second column, the cost is $59.15. So this is the MS Nutrition Thrifty Food Plan. And then the last two columns on the right, you see a beef version in red and a pork version in green on the far right. Let me emphasize here that all those diets were equally nutritious. Each of those diets fulfilled the nutrient requirements and each of those diets provided adequate nutrients. The question is, which of those diets provides you adequate nutrients at the lowest cost? And I think the data are very clear. There's no doubt that the pork-based diet is the one that gives you adequate nutrition at the lowest cost. Notice that we did not do anything with seafood and eggs or nuts and seeds. Those were not replaced by pork, only beef, pork, cured meat, and poultry were the ones that were subject to modification. So let's go on to the next slide, which actually is my summary slide. So in our Thrifty Food Plan analysis, beef and pork was separated, and replicating the USDA Thrifty Food Plan, our, that is to say, MS Nutrition Friend Linear Programming Model, selected pork to achieve a healthy diet at an even lower cost, and selecting pork as the only source of meat protein reduced the weekly cost of our Thrifty Food Plan even below by a few cents the USDA Thrifty Food Plan. And of course, I can't emphasize it sufficiently, selecting pork as the only source of protein still allowed for nutrient adequate diets. All of those diets were nutrient adequate and healthy. So these linear programming models track the work of USDA CNPP, and I want again to acknowledge their help and assistance. So I'll stop here and now turn things over to Shelley, who will tell you about the practical application of pork in affordable, healthy recipes, which are both nutritious and delicious. Thank you.
Thanks, Adam. Hi, everyone. My name is Shelley Maniscalco, and I'm a dietitian with Nutrition on Demand. And prior to this, I worked at USDA Center for Nutrition Policy and Promotion. I was responsible for the team leading up the 2015 Dietary Guidelines for Americans communications and MyPlate. So I'm absolutely thrilled to be here today to take all of that great data just presented by Adam and to put it into context for how we can use that to educate consumers to eat healthfully on a budget. Next slide, please. These are my disclosures, and you can go to the next slide. I wanted to start big picture, and Kara did a great job of setting this up in the beginning, but we're on this journey. This figure is from the American Heart Association, and it shows this journey that we're on from food sufficiency to food security to nutrition security. And that's important because along the way, at times, we have had food security and diet quality be parallel but related tracks. And now, by bringing everything together under the same tent with nutrition security, along with stable affordability and access and skill building, we can really have, no pun intended, everything baked right in, and we can help people achieve better diet quality. Next slide, please. But as you can imagine, especially given where we are with a healthy eating index of 59 out of 100, we have a long way to go when it comes to helping everybody have a better diet quality overall. And so it's going to take a village. It'll be all hands on deck. And this is a schematic that I modeled after our one of our favorite food guides of past, the pyramid. And it just shows the interplay between the policy, the educator, and consumers. Because as you can imagine, and I've worked in both the policy space and the consumer, those two buckets have a completely different language that they speak. And so it's really up to the educators to be the bridge between the policy and consumer behavior to help that communication between these two. Next slide, please. The Dietary Guidelines for Americans is the law of the land. It is geared toward a health professional audience. And the government also provides MyPlate, which is the consumer education arm. And it has three current focal areas that in addition to the food group visual you get, it helps us to align more with nutrition security by focusing on nutrient density, cost consciousness and simultaneously health equity. And these together help us develop a roadmap to actually hit home for the consumer in helping them change their behaviors. Next slide, please. Well, we're talking about the Thrifty Food Plan today. So what I'm trying to demonstrate on this slide is that at these different levels, there's different knowledge that needs to be had. So for instance, Adam was talking about the market basket percentages. And it's very helpful in the context of understanding the Thrifty Food Plan. But if you don't remember it verbatim, that's okay. Because really, to educate the consumer, we don't need to know the ins and outs of the market basket percentages. What we need to know is all the other good good information that's in that Thrifty Food Plan and went into the analysis that can help us provide those healthy, budget-friendly options and then be hand-in-hand with the consumer as they navigate all the stuff they have going on at home. Next slide, please. So we're going to stop here for a poll. And the poll is, do you agree that we must meet individuals and families where they are by addressing their top eating priorities and challenges? So I'll give you a second or two to choose one or the other. And Nate, when you're ready, you can put up the results. Okay. Overwhelmingly, we all agree that it's important to meet consumers where they are. We do that by addressing their priorities and their challenges. And really what we're trying to do is help them understand how to build a healthy dietary pattern with the food that they love, on a budget, and within all the other constraints they experience. So no big deal. We can do all that. But the way that I like to focus how we do it and how we help them with their how they do it is through SMART goals. So it's really the same concept that we use at work to make sure that we're staying on track and that we know what we need to do on a day-to-day basis. So helping deliver messages and tips that are some combination of specific, manageable, actionable, realistic, and time-bound, we can do just that. But again, first we need to understand where they are in order to meet them there. So next slide. This is a snapshot of just that. So we know that taste is the number one driver of food choice by far. This is IFIC food and health survey data, and they've been doing this survey for 12 years and asking this question for 12 years. And never in that period of time has taste dipped below 80%. Price is consistently second place. And I don't have this on here, but health is actually third place. But it's important to note that only three times in the past 12 years has health really, really touched price in terms of being of equal consequence in drivers of food choice. So that's really important for us to understand as educators, because we're a passionate bunch. We are interested in health. We're interested in nutrition. And sometimes we get excited and go out with that. But then that way we wouldn't be, if we do that, we're not really speaking to their priority of taste and price, but we can sneak some of that in, and I'll show you how. SNAP participants particularly report barriers to achieving a healthy diet over the course of the month. And so it's 88% of them, and then 61% cite cost as a barrier. And speaking of cost, inflation is a real challenge, especially these days. And we know a lot of consumers are experiencing some major pain at the register. And just between 2021 in June and June of 2022, in that year that the Thrifty Food Plan was out, we saw a cost of food rising 12.5%. And while this doesn't have anything to do with taste or cost, it's important to realize that most of us don't eat in a vacuum. In fact, we are eating with a household, with our family, with a group of friends, and that creates some nuances that we have to balance when making healthy eating a priority. So next slide. Because this is a big job, I'm going to present the 5 steps to helping your audience eat healthfully and flavorfully on a budget. And these are intended to guide your messaging and your tips that you're going out there to your audience with. The first one is start with what they're already eating. 2, understand and consider the nuances of their food choices. 3, then we need to optimize for health, followed by identifying low-cost options, and finally matching with their skill set and lifestyle. Next slide, please. And if any of you, and I can't see those of you who are on this call, but I would assume that some of you are experiential learners like me. So I'm going to actually go through each of those steps. And since we're talking about pork today, I'll use pork as a case study, and you can kind of see how I'm thinking about this. Next slide. Number 1, starting with what they're already eating. So as humans, we are creatures of habit, and we are also resistant to change at times, particularly big change and particularly sustaining that change. So think about the percentage of people who go on a diet only to change what they're doing for a small portion of time and then to go, you know, off the diet. This is what I'm talking about. So by figuring out what our audience is already eating and what they love eating, we can really build from there. So people love pork. It is the most widely consumed meat in the entire world, and it can be used and is used very versatile across day parts. We also know, aside from that, that sandwiches are a good carrier of foods. And in fact, they are the most common food type consumed in the US. And then speaking of carriers, we also know based on the dietary guidelines that fruits and vegetables are very underconsumed in our country. And so is there a way that we can take salads and sandwiches, which are top carrier foods for fruits and vegetables, and make some sort of combination that really helps consumers choose what they love, get the extra fruits and veggies, and play on their sandwich habit. And this smart tip just does that. Next slide, please. Number 2 is understanding the nuances of food choices. So yes, we know that people choose based on taste, price, sometimes healthfulness, but really that's a simplification of what we experience at home. So for instance, you know, do you have a picky eater or someone who's following a specific medically prescribed diet? Or do you have a lot of activities after school or a job that you work nights where it's really hard to figure out something that works for everyone and not be a short order cook? We also need to understand that there are cultural food ways and people eat differently. And so we want to help everybody. So we know that pork is a mainstay in traditional dishes across many cultures, which is probably why it's the most consumed meat worldwide. And then we also know that from survey that I referenced earlier, that SNAP participants in particular lack cooking equipment as well as storage, and that's a barrier. And then we also know, I mean, mostly from personal experience, but also talking to clients that time is a challenge. So here is a smart tip that gets in time and you're not using a lot of cooking equipment and is a cultural favorite recipe. Next slide, please. Here's where the negotiation comes in, because finding out, understanding your consumer is potentially the easy part, but when you sit across from somebody, a patient, or when you're talking to a neighbor or a family member who asks you about nutrition, you give them your answer. And how many times have you gotten a blank stare, or worse, the, yeah, I'm not going to do that? That's where we are. So this is where the negotiation starts, and we can kind of steer people in the right direction. So if they love pork, we can steer them toward the leaner cuts, the tenderloin, the chops. I do like thinking here about helping people understand what to add versus what to take away, because again, as humans, we don't like to be deprived. So adding in fruits and vegetables, adding in flavor with spices and herbs, and this can offset the taste changes that occur when you cut salt and reduce saturated fat. So here is a smart tip that does that. Next slide, please. Yeah, so this is actually a visual taken directly from the Thrifty Food Plan. And I just love this table because there's a table in the Thrifty Food Plan, and someone from CMPP can tell us which one, but it has all of the food groups and subgroups, and it tells you for each of them which choices are higher nutrient density and lower cost. And so by knowing that, you can see here that the majority of the lower cost, high nutrient dense meat options are pork. And so you can, again, steer the consumer in that direction. And here is a smart tip that gets that education in there while still being fun. Next, please. And finally, step five. So this is, I think, where as nutrition educators, we can really shine, because sometimes we're just limited mostly by our own, you know, lack of time to imagine the possibilities. So, you know, me as a dietitian and a working mom know this stuff, but sometimes even my family gets into a rut. So here's where we can, you know, educate the skill of cost per unit to help our patients and our audience navigate the grocery store and pick the lower cost items that are available at that time. We can help them by reimagining cooking methods. So something easy that doesn't take a lot of cooking equipment, like roasting, is something that our audience may not even think of when thinking about cooking. And then always providing recipes. I know in all the consumer research that I've done, the enjoyment of recipes and the need for more always comes up pretty high. And so here are a couple of great sites for recipes and a smart tip that gets to some creativity of subbing in some ground pork in favorites. Next slide, please. In summary, in addition to the five steps that we will send you and you can use them and navigate in for your specific audience in your practice, I want to emphasize these three things. One, taste and cost are the top drivers of food choice. I cannot say that enough. So if we start with what they love and help them understand what's affordable, we can really make a difference in helping people build healthier dietary patterns. Two, we can be the expert that helps get in there with the recipes that they're already doing at home and just tweak them slightly to make them over to be healthier and still enjoyable. And then three, thinking about combination dishes and carrier foods as a way to, again, help people create their my plate essentially in a healthy way to get all of the nutrients and the food groups that they need to get into to get the HEI up there. And with that, I will hand it over to Ellen.
Shelley, thank you so much. And a special thanks to the National Pork Board for sponsoring this webinar and to all the attendees who are taking the time to join us for it. Next slide, please. And next slide. Food Research and Action Center is a national anti-hunger organization. We're based in Washington, D.C., but we work with partners across the country at the national, state, and local levels. We conduct research, education, policy advocacy, and our particular focus is on the federal nutrition programs, including SNAP, school meals, WIC, and others. Next slide, please. As our prior speakers have already pointed out, there is a significant link between the Thrifty Food Plan and SNAP. Of course, SNAP is Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, used to be called food stamps. Thrifty Food Plan does provide the basis for determining the amount of benefits that a household can qualify for in SNAP. And it is a lifeline. SNAP provides a cost-effective and efficient way for government to augment the food purchasing power of millions of households with low incomes. It runs on the regular rails of commerce, Benefits are loaded onto electronic benefit transfer cards, EBT. Those are processed like other credit and debit cards at authorized food retailers. That means that SNAP shoppers through SNAP are able to shop in ways that are similar to other customers and at outlets that other customers use, and to choose their foods that will fit the needs of their particular household, and to be able to do that with dignity. A major shortcoming, though, and we'll see it as we look at this quote on the slide, is that the benefit amounts are very, very modest. So let's see how two customers describe what it's like to be dealing with SNAP. Now, the first SNAP EBT was comfort when we were dealing with the medical bills, and it really helped. It would be great if they can raise the amount so there's actually enough, but it was a real help. I remember having to get over the stigma. I said to my husband, we need to do this to help ourselves, so let's get over any shame. The EBT card is actually really nice, but I think it would still be nice to have an increase. It helped my dad, who is disabled, get some items. I just wish it could be a little bit more substantial. And now with inflation, you can buy less. Next slide. I learned how to stretch food stamps, but you don't get much. You have to find ways, and it's not always consistent. Basically, it's meager. You don't get all the meats and cheese. You get the basics. You get what you need to stay alive. So you're missing out on a lot of things. But we always try to stretch nutrition no matter what you get. Next slide, please. So let's see what kind of dollar amounts the customers are talking about, even though benefits do vary from household to household, and they're calibrated to some extent on the amount of income that a household has and their household size. Even with the important adjustment that's already been described that was made to the Thrifty Food Plan to update it again, the first time it was updated so that the value of the package could be increased. Even with that plus up, benefits still only go so far today. The average per person SNAP benefits, not counting some temporary COVID relief that's been added to many of the SNAP participants' allotments. When we just look at the basic benefit based on Thrifty, it went before the Thrifty food adjustment to a little over $4 a person a day on SNAP to over $5 a person a day on SNAP. That's a significant change, but again, we're talking about very, very modest, meager, low, however you want to use, whatever adjectives you want to use for what people need to be able to obtain food. You know, together though, with the emergency allotments that are alluded to, these are these temporary benefits that the federal government has made available if states want to leverage them for their SNAP households during COVID-19. That, together with the adjustment in Thrifty and the basic, brings up average benefits to about $8 a person a day. Again, a meaningful difference for people. It's one of the things that's helped shield many, many people from even more stress and hunger and hardship during COVID-19 than they would have faced otherwise, but still a very low dollar amount. Next slide, please. Where are we today? Today, most states are still leveraging the extra benefits for their SNAP households that the federal government's made available, those so-called SNAP emergency allotments, or you might sometimes hear them referred to as the EAs. But those are only in place so long as the federal government and states where they're leveraged have emergency public health emergency declarations for COVID in force. And when the HHS public health emergency declaration ends, the one that was first put in January of 2020 and has been extended since, whenever that does end, so will the SNAP emergency allotments. And at that point, a hunger cliff is what is on the minds of a lot of people, people who understand the SNAP system, and it's on the mind of SNAP clients who know that these temporary plus-ups will go away at some point. and that hunger cliff is expected to affect millions of SNAP participants. We know the hunger cliff is not going to be as steep as it would have been had the Thrifty Food Plan adjustment not been made in October of 2021. But nonetheless, even with that in place, when the emergency allotments end, after COVID-19, when the declaration ends, the SNAP benefits are expected to drop on average by about $82 a person a month. That is going to be quite significant. It would be significant probably for anyone's budget, but we're talking about people with extremely low incomes and extremely tight budgets. Next slide, please. There are, of course, ways to strengthen SNAP benefit adequacy, and we've got on the slide just examples of some of them. One example would be to use the food plan that is just one step above the Thrifty Food Plan on the list of foods the federal government calculates packages for. That's the so-called low-cost food plan. That doesn't sound, I suppose, to most people when they hear low-cost food, doesn't sound like a tremendously large package. But nonetheless, it would still be an improvement over the bottom rung program, which or package, which is Thrifty Food Plan. And we think, and I think there are a number of researchers who believe, it provides a more realistic barometer of the real costs of obtaining a nutritious diet throughout the month. But there are other ways to strengthen SNAP benefit adequacy. One is to use, is to do more to help SNAP deductions better reflect people's out-of-pocket costs. There's always been a recognition in SNAP, and before it was called that in food stamps, that if a low-income household has got things going out of pocket for other basics, particularly shelter, childcare, that that money is not then still available for them to be able to use toward food. And so SNAP does have some ways of taking into account those other pressures on the budget to determine how much to give a household in benefits. There certainly would be a way to help more families with children not have to face the choices that too many of them face, particularly during a tough winter season in the North and Midwest and Pacific Coast. And that is whether they're going to be able to pay for heating or eating or paying for rent or paying for food. The most important way to do that would be to take a cap off the amount of the out-of-pocket costs that SNAP will take into account for those households. Similarly, there are ways to ease the pay for food or pay for medicine dilemma that so many older people and people with disabilities face. And so there are ways to streamline taking into account the out-of-pocket medical costs that they have. And of course, there are also ways just to make sure that people who are qualified for SNAP, eligible for SNAP, do go ahead and get connected with the benefits. And that will allow more of them to have healthy food more in reach. Next slide, please. Clearly, we have lots more resources from all of the panelists. I've given you on this slide the URL for our website. It's www.frac.org. We have a lot more on SNAP in general, but in particular on SNAP benefit adequacy. And we hope you'll keep in touch with us. I really appreciated the opportunity to talk with you today. I look forward to your questions and comments, and I'm going to turn this back to Marvin.
Thank you, Ellen. And first of all, can we just give a virtual kudos to our presenters today? They did a really great job of presenting their individual parts. And they'll also be sticking around to answer any questions that you might have on the Thrifty Food Plan, the research on the affordability and nutrient density of pork, or anything else that you might want to know as it relates to SNAP benefits. As you go and claim your one CPU for this presentation, check the chat for today's suggested performance indicators. This is also an ethics-related CPEU activity, so do not forget that. Your CPU certificate of attendance will be mailed out via email after today's presentation, so please check your inbox and let us know if you have any questions as it relates to today's webinar or the certificate by emailing us at nutrition@pork.org. Again, email us at nutrition@pork.org if you have any questions or comments. If you are watching this webinar as a recording, that's okay. Participants who watch this webinar as a recording can claim their CPEU by visiting porkcheckoff.org under the news tab. And again, that is by visiting porkcheckoff.org under the news tab.